Hey, what do you say, boys and girls? This is Bobby Blitz with Joshua Toomey and his rock cocks.
Welcome to Diablos in Podcastica with Toomey and Wadzilla.
What is up, everybody? Welcome into another episode of Diablos in Podcastica. As always, I am Joshua Toomey, joined by...
Yeah, that's cheap vodka in a plastic cup, bitches. We're recording on a Friday. I'm getting vodka drunk. Man, fucking vodka, man.
Sounded like you had some sort of toy gun over there or something. I didn't know what was going on.
Yeah. That was my... oh, by the way, I'm Wadzilla. that was my douche flute. My e-cigarette hitting my plastic Iron Maiden cup that I paid $137 for.
Wow.
On the Final Frontier tour. Well, yeah, it was for a set of three, you know.
Where are the other two?
So, what's that? Well, I can only, you know, it's like a fucking moose cup, man. I can only drink one at a time. The other two are in the fucking cupboard.
All right. Well, anything going on, man? What's going on down there in New Orleans? Is everything calmed down a little bit?
Some protesting, you know, going on in the city right now, and somebody got shot, a chick got shot in the chest at a protest the other day, but reportedly it was unrelated to the protest, which is good. Last weekend sucked, man. It's been a shit week. I had to put down my beloved Stinky last Saturday.
What is that? Who's that? What is that? What? I don't know Stinky.
Stinky was my special needs cat.
Oh.
And that was my little buddy, man. But he has, you know, he'd had issues his whole life. And what I thought was just going to be a minor trip to the vet ended up being a lot worse than I thought. And that sucked. I had never, ever had to put down a pet before. You know, and I've had pets my whole life, but like, you know, the dog I grew up with, I was already moved away.
Yeah.
When she passed. So I didn't have to like really deal with it. My first beloved cat, the girlfriend took him. So I wasn't there when he passed. My second cat stayed with a previous girlfriend. I wasn't there when he passed. And this was the first one I had to do and be right there and touching them when it happened, you know, and it was, oh my God.
Wow.
I was crying like a bitch, man. It was really, that's, you know, it's hard to believe all the pets I've owned, and at 46, this is the first one I ever had to put down. But, yeah, man, that sucked. And anybody who's ever had to do that, you know, and I didn't even tell anybody at work because I didn't want to talk about it. You know, because I didn't want to get upset. And, you know, I'm just saying it now because I know that we got a lot of pet lovers and shit that listen to this show that can probably identify, or someday they'll identify. But, yeah, that was, you know, you keep thinking, like, what else can happen in 2020? You know, it's like, holy fucking shit. And, you know, my only solace is, you know, he lived a lot longer than I ever thought he was going to live. And I gave him the best life he could and a lot of love, and he's not suffering. So, but yeah, it's hard. I'm the crazy cat man is now down to two cats, and I'm gonna keep it that way. You know, I didn't plan on having three, but yeah, you know, a stray one suckered me in, and I took him in, but. I'm going to stick with the two.
Yeah. But, sounds like your lady life, you know, a stray one suckered you in, you brought her in.
Yeah. Yeah, those stray ones will get you every time. But, nah, it was really, really fucked up my weekend, that's for damn sure.
I bet, but, man. Yeah, you know, it's funny, when I first moved to Louisville back in 2003, I took the oldest cat that we had. We had a cat and like two kittens, and I took the cat, like the oldest cat, with me. And when I got to my apartment, I just noticed like the litter box never had anything in it, and it was for like a week, or you know, a few days. And I was like, you know, something's just not right here. The cat was like 17, and so finally I took it to the vet, and they were like, yeah, it's got blockage. It basically has cement in its intestines right now. And to get all of this fixed, it's going to be like, you know, $300. And in 2003, I did not have $300 for food or anything. So I kind of had to look at him and be like, you know, well, how much will it be to put him down? Because he was 17 and I just didn't have the money. And, you know, tears in my eyes. And finally, the vet walks back over to me and he handed me the list. And he had marked everything out that was going to cost so much money. It ended up costing me $20. And they kept the cat over the weekend and basically just gave it enemas like all weekend. And the look on the cat's face when I picked it up on Monday was the best. Like, he is like, you motherfucker, where did you leave me? Do you know what they did to me all weekend? And you're an asshole.
I had an option. He had a like kind of like a seizure and ate his tail like really bad. Like, I came home Friday night and there was blood everywhere and I was like, oh my God. But it was like a thin, you know, it wasn't like a pool of blood. It was just like, you could tell he had a cut and like freaked out and went all over the place. And they would have had to amputate, you know, if I was to keep him, they would have amputated his tail, and that was $1,500. And I just, you know, I didn't have it, and the vet was realized. They know, because I've had to take them there multiple, you know, plenty of times over the years and stuff. And she's like, I don't say this lightly, but, you know, this is probably the most humane thing you could do, because even if we have to take the tail, not to say he's not going to have, you know, more seizures and attack himself again. And so, but man, that's, you know, you go to the vet thinking, okay, you know, they're going to put some, you know, he's going to get a couple shots, they're going to put a Band-Aid on his boo-boo. And, you know, you're going to go home. And then you end up going home with an empty fucking pet carrier.
Oof.
Yeah, that's a motherfucker. You know, and then, you know, the other two cats going, hey, you know, where's the slow one at? You know?
Right.
And, you know, and the fucked up thing is that cat woke me up like every morning I was, you know, home for 8 years. He woke me up every morning. You know, he wasn't the smartest cat, but he knew how to wake you up when he was hungry. And to not have him there anymore, and
It's gonna be rough, man. All right, so what's our list of shit going on this year that's fucked up? We got COVID-19. You got your COVID testing. You know, you've got a quarantine Ian. You've got riots and you know, police killings and car accidents and murder hornets.
Everybody's forgetting about these fucking murder hornets. That's going to be the one to sneak up and bite you in the ass.
You know, cats passing away. You know, we've been trying to buy a house, and I guess, like, with COVID-19, somehow, like, COVID-19 fucked up the entire loan industry, so they raised all of their standards, like, through the roof. So on a normal Tuesday, we could buy a house. We could basically walk in and buy a house and walk back out. Now you got to jump through all these hoops and get approved for a loan and stuff, and it's just like, God damn it, man. Just fucking, like, how can you not see that we can pay the goddamn mortgage? Like, give me a house. Give me a new house.
Yeah. And, oh, man. And then I got a message earlier this week. You know, one of my longtime listeners and loves this show, Mike Glammire, his mother passed away. And, you know, he sent me a very nice message, you know, let me know, you know, we gave him a shout out in the last episode, and he's like, man, that's, you know, that's what I needed. You know, you put a smile on my face, you know, for a couple minutes, you know, and it's like, oh, fuck, you know, I'm like, man, you know, here I'm fucking crying like a fucking 5-year-old bitch with a skinned knee over a dead cat. And, you know, this guy just lost his mom. And, you know, then I found out today, my second ex-wife, Dr. Fuck, is in the hospital, and
yeah, I
guess
that.
He's not doing too good. And, you know, we don't get along these days, but I don't wish no fucking harm on nobody, you know, especially him. I don't wish no ill health or anything. I hope he gets better. But, man, it's a fucked up year, you know. I'm afraid that, like, at some point in this year, Sammy's going to be back in Van Halen, and I'm just going to jump off the fucking roof. And what sucks is my place is only 2 stories, so I'll probably live, but I'll be hurt, you know.
You'll just be annoyed.
Yeah, yeah. It'll just be like a, you know, be like in Family Guy when he hits his shin. You know, it's like, oh, oh. You know, but it's like, you know, what else? You know, this has just been a horrible year. And normally, you know, any time with a new year, but especially with a new decade, you know, there's always like, okay, you know, new decade, new hopes, you know, new, you know, it's everything, you know, always hope for the best and think things are going to get better. And hey, it's the new roaring 20s and holy fuck. And it's the new depression. And, you know, it's like, God damn.
Yeah, it's a mess.
You know, but at least we have this positive podcast to cheer people up with great news of dead pets and dead mothers and hospitalized podcasters and,
oh,
and you know, can't get no homes and shit. Wow.
Yeah, well.
I mean, next thing you know, Crazy Town's going to put out a new record.
Oh, wait a
know?
Minute.
Oh, God, don't tell me.
Wait till the news.
But, yeah, we'll save it for the news.
You know, some people that we do love and we do cherish are our henchmen.
Oh, yeah.
Our henchmen.
Yeah. And, man, we got a ton of responses from our Ride the Lightning episode from last week. So yeah, let's get it started off here. Keith Rockford, Jay Sablewski, Adam Cox, Chuck Lopson, Anthony Bonet, Mark Alden Taylor, Samuel Wetz, Kenneth Waugh, Christopher Ellefson, Bill Elam, Mike Glendemeyer, James West, Eric Gordon, Chris Sinzak, Bob Reed, David Cathy, and Daniel Lee are our henchmen for the week. And if you would like to become a henchman, make sure you're heading over to the Facebook page, sharing from the Diablo Sim Podcastica Facebook page. Share the episode, let your friends know you're listening to the show, do our dirty work, and be our henchmen.
Well, I tell you, I got to pick a henchman of the week this week, though. Because, you know, it's funny, on the podcast page that I, the group page that I do, that you're not part of because you're a prick. oh, my God, we got a lot of response. You know, I was talking about people, I'm not listening to Cheap Trick anymore. Well, I got a lot of, I'm not listening to Diablos and Podcastic anymore. And, you know, some people, you know, were, you know, funny about it, creative, but man. Kenneth, wow, really went off. I think we lost him as a listener.
Did we? What happened?
Oh, man, he just went, you know, not only, you know, is he not going to listen to the show anymore, but he went off on you in particular.
Oh, yeah?
Holy shit. I mean, the things he said about you. hold on, let me bring it up, because it's a fucking laundry list. Complaints he had about you.
Oh, great.
Not only did he not like your support of Black Lives Matter, he says he's seen YouTube footage of you playing live with Primer 55 and you were wearing blackface.
Well, you know. I did replace a black member of the band, so I just had to keep the tradition going. I'm like the Al Jolson of nu metal.
He said he heard that you were a delivery boy at the pizza parlor that Hillary Rodham Clinton ran the child molestation ring out of.
Yeah. Hey, man, you gotta make some money somehow.
Oh, my God. He said your wife must be 12 years old because you don't fuck with anything older than that. And he also made fun of her car. he said he saw your profile on Grindr. And he said, your dick looks like the singer from Disturbed. And he said,
why
the only
was he
reason
on Grindr?
That he didn't say.
But you know, you have to be on Grindr to see me on Grindr. You don't just stumble upon that. You got to download that. Well,
he said that your cock's not even that big. It was just obvious that you had a small child holding it. And that you were fooling no one. He said he went to a... Five Finger Death Punch concert and name dropped you and he got moved up to the front row. Now he no longer enjoys music.
yeah,
oh my
that
God.
That might actually work.
He just went on and on, but yeah, he's not going to listen to us anymore, ever again.
Well, good. Well, hopefully he won't share this next week. Maybe he will not be a henchman.
Yeah. Oh, boy, you ought to have heard the shit he said about me.
What did he say about you?
He said I'm even better looking in person.
Yeah,
but he thought I'd be taller.
Well, yeah, so, you do project a very tall voice.
Yeah, you know, so, you know, he didn't spare me either, you know, but you got the brunt of it. But, hey, thanks for participating, you know. Hope you come back next week. Next week is the All Lives Matters episode, and everybody will forgive us, you know. At least all the white kids will.
So. We are the NASCAR of podcasting, you know. We're all-inclusive, bringing everybody yes. in together.
Yeah, we are the NASCAR podcast. We don't fly the flag for nothing. We just are. We just are. We're a show for dumb white people. And dumb people of all colors.
Yeah, we are all inclusive with all colors of
yeah. we don't see color. We just all see, you know, horrible paychecks because we're bad people who are poorly educated.
Nice. You know, one thing we do see, and that's Apple Podcast reviews. And we got a great one this week, so I want you to read this great one we got. I didn't know we had it until right before we started recording.
Yeah. Yeah, this is a great one. This is from Speaky Clout, a 5-star review entitled Amazing. He says, and I quote, Ian had told me he was in the works of a new show a few months back. I'm no longer on Facebook, so I searched Ian Wadley on Spotify, and the new podcast showed up. Been binge listening lately to every episode. My good brother Ian is still a comedian and has me laughing just like the good old Rock and Metal Combat podcast days. The Toomey guy has good chemistry with Ian. Very great show. Keep up the good work, fellas. Wadzilla is my brother for life, and I will support him until the wheels fall off. Oh, yeah! Mike Sears. Hell yeah. Mike Sears, longtime listener of mine. And super nice guy. And heads up, everybody. I'm going to be on his podcast probably in about 2 weeks. We're going to record it. And then, you know, however long it takes him to edit, you know, my ramblings. But we are going to do a Slayer-related episode.
Nice.
And when that's up, I will post it on the group page so you can check it out. You know, everybody that's been on the page for years, they already know Brother Mike and how awesome he is. And very excited to be part of that. So I appreciate, you know, leaving the review, man. That's awesome. And we also have some other reviews on the fan page too, right?
Yeah, we've got a bunch of Facebook fan page ones, or some Facebook recommendations. So I did want to read this one from a good friend, Bill Elam.
Yo, yeah, I like that guy.
Two raiders of rock, metal, and pop culture bring you the news, the best of the old and the new, great stories and interviews too. Listen now or prepare to forgive yourself for being wrong. Much love, Pimpin' Ho.
Oh, man, Bill is so awesome. And, you know, got to hang out with Bill at the Rockin' Pods. And I tell you, you know, if you're going to do meth with somebody, I'm just saying. Bill got that good shit.
You know, if I was good to edit guy. This, it would. We are two titans of rock, metal, and pop
yeah,
culture.
Yeah, no, Raiders.
Raiders. You know,
you already got your fucking Titans review. Let me get my fucking Raiders review.
You know, it's funny.
Don't worry. After the season starts, I won't want to bring them up again.
Hey, Marcus Mariota is going to take you 9-7, baby. You know, you're fantastic Hawaiian quarterback. You know, it's funny. We were out looking at houses the other day, and we fell in love with this house, right? And we're like, man, we got to put an offer in on this house. And I look across the street, and in the garden, in their little garden in the front yard, a little Raiders flag. And I was like, babe, we got to go. This is a bad neighborhood. We got to get out of here.
Oh, yeah, that's a neighborhood for men, for manly men.
You know, actually, you know, yeah. Another great story from the looking at houses. You know, I'm technically in Southern Indiana, and so there are a lot of Colts fans here, and that's like, you know, you probably hate the Chiefs and the Broncos. I cannot stand the Colts with a passion. And we were looking at a house the other day, and, you know, we're digging it. We didn't think we were going to buy it, but we were digging it, and I turn a corner, and I go into this one room in the basement, and it had to have been the homeboy's man cave room, and there was a framed Adam Vinatieri autographed jersey and a Peyton Manning full-size fat head and the the painting the Colts colors and just, you know, a football helmet. And I was just like, like, I had to get out of there. I was like, babe, we got to go. This is also a bad neighborhood. We got to get out of here.
Man, I thought they had outlawed all cult stuff in Indiana. Didn't Mike Pence make everything gay illegal?
I do believe so. Hey, Mike Pence was the governor of Indiana, wasn't he?
Yeah, something like that. Yeah, it had to be one of those backwards ass states, Indiana. Although I do love me some Indiana Beach, if it's still there. Is Indiana Beach still there? Do you know?
I have no idea what you're talking about.
It's just I think it's a man-made lake. It's in Monticello, Indiana. Oh. And it's one of two reasons people from Illinois would go to Indiana. You know, fireworks and Indiana Beach. That's the only way we would, go to that state.
Is that at the northern tip of Indiana?
I don't think Indiana Beach is. I don't know.
Indiana Beach and Amusement Park. That's like up at the top of Indiana. I'm at the very bottom.
Oh, really? Okay, well, shit, then it was probably close. I don't know. Everything seemed like a long car ride when you're a kid.
Yeah, right.
But
it's funny. You take those car rides that you thought were like 4 days when you were a kid, and you take them now, and you're like, oh, we're already here.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I grew up like, you know, within a half hour I could be in Indiana. Probably less, you know, if I'm on coke. But, we didn't go that often. Unless it was fireworks or Indiana Beach.
Well, if you're up in the Chicago area, I mean, the closest thing is, what, Gary? You definitely don't want to be going through Gary, Indiana.
Ooh, I got the first time I ever went to Gary, Indiana, I got lost after my first and only time seeing Metallica. Me and my buddy Mike Zeller were partying, and that motherfucker fell asleep on the way home. And we lived, you know, we were 50 minutes south of Chicago. But I missed my exit, and somehow I ended up in Gary, Indiana. And that was the first time I ever saw bulletproof glass.
Nice.
And this is how old I am. The first time I ever saw a gas station where you had to pay before you pump.
Nice.
You know, back in the day, hell, we used to steal gas all the time.
Stop and ask for directions, and as the person's talking to you, they stole everything off of your car?
No, I didn't get, but it, I just remember, like, it being so weird. Like, you know, I went to ask the guy for directions, and it's like, talking through bulletproof glass, and it's the kind of thing where, you know, you got to stick your money in, you know, they send the thing out. I'd never seen that before. You know, I'm old, but, you know, everything quickly went to that. But at that time, that was new to me. And then I went there one other time when I used to sell vacuums. Yes, door to door. I did good, too. But I had an appointment to go see somebody in Gary, Indiana that I was supposed to sell a vacuum to. And while I'm looking for the house, gunfire erupted, and I just left. I'm like, fuck this place. I'm out of here. That was in the middle of the day. Like, Gary, Indiana, holy shit. No wonder the Jacksons are so badass. You gotta be tough. You gotta be tough in Gary, Indiana.
No one has ever called the Jacksons tough.
Oh, man, they're tough. Well, hey, man, if you're gonna molest little kids and get away with it, you gotta be tough, man.
Oh.
You gotta be tough.
Is that T-U-F-F tough?
Yeah. Yeah, like the band. Michael Jackson's about as tough as that band.
It's about as tough as Stevie Rochelle.
Yeah, but you know, don't get it twisted, man. Tito would fuck some shit up. You know, I wouldn't want to fight Tito. Tito probably got a lot of anger. Probably because he had to pay before he pumped. It's like, what, you don't trust me?
And that's when racial inequality started.
Damn right. Damn right.
All right, man. Well, you guys got some news?
Oh, do we got some news? Okay. Well, we got the aforementioned, holy shit, a new single from Crazy Town. And I had to check it out. I mean, I know it's going to be bad. I know it's going to be bad. And I knew it was going to be even worse than fucking Butterfly. And goddamn, if I wasn't right, did you hear that shit?
Contrary to a popular belief, I'm not a Crazy Town fan. So no, I did not check it out.
No, but I mean, out of some kind of morbid curiosity, you know, you didn't click on it just to see how bad it was?
No, no.
Oh, well, it is bad. Rest assured, it is bad. But I did hear two other songs this week that were even worse. So I got to give Crazy Town a little bit of props. Their shit wasn't as bad as two other songs I heard this week. But, yeah, stay away from Crazy Town. That shit's terrible. And it's Crazy Town with a guest rapper. And that poor guy, boy, you want to talk about a career kiss of death, you know. Oh, what was your last job? Oh, I guessed it on a Crazy Town single. Yeah, they're like, sorry, you're not qualified enough to work the fryer at fucking McDonald's. Oh, shit. Hey, it's pretty bad.
Hyro the Hero is not too bad. Guest on there. But what were the other two songs that you heard? Are you getting to those, or are you just leaving us out to dry?
Yeah, I think those will be a story later. We'll get to it. It's somebody that deserves a whole lot of shame and more talking about it.
All right.
But what you got?
Well, one of the favorite topics of the show, Ace Frehley, will play a pair of shows this summer that will apparently respect guidelines aimed at limiting the spread of the new coronavirus. The original Kiss guitarist is scheduled to perform at Jurgles in Warrendale, Pennsylvania on August 6th and at Robbins Theater in Warren, Ohio on August 7th. So, after the unplanned break, the Robbins Theater is preparing to reopen in compliance with the Responsible Restart Ohio guidelines as set forth by the Ohio Department of Health. The message notes, and as we move forward, the safety of those who enter the facility is at the forefront of our efforts. As you may already know, our restrooms are completely touchless, so you should not touch your penis while peeing. Just let it go everywhere. Additionally, an electrostatic deep cleaning of the entire theater will be performed before we open. So, there you go. So, if you want to go see Ace Frehley, Warrendale, Pennsylvania at Jurgles, and Warren, Ohio at Robbins Theater. You going to head up for those shows?
Well, we'll see. You know, I'm still a little worried about this COVID shit, you know, and if they're really looking out for the audience, they're going to give them earplugs too. You know, if he's playing solo shit, you know, anything other than, you know, 78 solo album's great. If it's all Kiss shows, I'd go see Ace. He got a good backing band with him now. But, boy, if he plays any of these last fucking 25 solo albums he put out, no. That's some horrible shit. I don't care. I don't care what anybody says. You fucking Kiss nerds, admit it. Those new Ace Frehley solo albums are fucking wretched. Wretched. Bad.
What are your thoughts on Ace being kind of the forefather of, like, all of the stoner rock? As in, like, I know Sabbath gets a lot of that, but I think that Ace's vocal style should, you know, Caius and a lot of those bands, real heavy on that Ace vocal style.
Yeah, Curly. Yeah, they sound just like him. I admit what an influence he is, you know, guitar-wise, you know, because everybody's got to start somewhere, you know. If your first song had to be a fucking Jimi Hendrix riff, nobody play guitar.
Man. Yeah. Are you dissing Ace Frehley?
Yeah, I'm dissing Ace Frehley.
Horrible.
Yeah. Hey, man, he fired that guy while his wife was dying. That's a dick move. I lost a lot of respect for Ace after that. That's a dick move. And his solo albums are fucking garbage, you know?
I almost fired you last week as your cat was dying, so I don't want to hear it.
Yeah. I believe it. It's all about the bottom end.
I'm about to fire Dr. Fuck, too, because he's in the hospital.
Yeah. quick before he passes away, fire his ass. I'd go see Ace, but man, I mean, really, anybody who could listen to those new solo albums and go, oh yeah, that's great tunes, or, you know, I really can't see anybody listening to it more than once. I could see you buying it because you're a hardcore Kiss fan and you want to support Ace, but, you know, are you really going to put it back on a month from now? I don't know. Somebody's going to lie and say they do. Well, Mick Watkins is probably actually listening to it, but that's a whole nother can of worms. I love you, Mick.
Yeah, he actually turned that off to listen to this, so.
Oh, yeah. No, no, now he just turned us off to go back to listen to fucking Anomaly.
Damn it.
Said no one.
Him and Aaron Camaro are just like, you know, what's your favorite Ace song? No, what's your favorite? I love that one the most. No, I love that one the most.
You leave Aaron Camaro alone. He's got enough problems. He has to do a show with Chris Sinzak.
Yeah, and he named his kid Ace, though.
Yeah. Yeah, I'd rather go see Ace Camaro right now. and if you go see Ace Camaro, it's actually him playing guitar.
Nice.
It's not a Bob Kulick tape loop.
I saw Ace in 95, and then I saw him again in 2016, I think. Both times I had a lot of fun, man. I'm a big Ace fan of the Kiss stuff and some of his solo stuff. You know, he in the 2016 show, I mean, I know it was mainly, you know, the solo stuff, the Kiss stuff he did, you know, Rock Soldiers. You know, you got to listen to the Rock Soldiers, New York Groove, all that stuff. You got all the hits.
Oh, fucking New York. God, do I hate that fucking song. Oh, my God, I hate that fucking song. I love that album, though. I think it's great, and I always get shit because I say Paul Stanley's album is better than Ace's, and that's only for a simple math. There's two songs I hate on Ace's, only one I hate on Paul's. So I give Paul the nod. But, I mean, that 78 Ace album, aside from those two abortions, yeah, it's great. But in my mind, he never even came close to it at all. I mean, Rock Soldiers is kind of fucking... That's some silly shit, you know? I'll take Into the Night over that, and that's a fucking cover. And then the albums just get worse from there, you know? Especially this latest batch. Oh, my God. Space Invader, Anomaly, whatever. Spaceman, whatever. Oh, that it's horrible. It's anybody saying that's top notch shit is you're fucking delusional. You are just in that fucking Kiss bubble because that shit's, oh God. But hey, go see him live. If he's playing the good shit, if he's playing like the classic old Kiss and mostly the 78 solo album, yeah, that's going to be a fun show. You know, because he's got a really good band with him. You know. But, he does for now until one of their wives gets sick and then they don't get a new band. You know, you don't want to pay those insurance premiums.
No, it's terrible. Oh. You're terrible, man. Yeah, he definitely is cashing in on that space theme. You know, all of the space stuff. I think he said on the Eddie Trunk show the other day that he's doing a cover of Space Truckin'. You know, it's just like, all right, come on now.
Oh, God, to match that new space wig. Holy shit, is that bad. Oh, my God. That's like fucking roadkill. That's roadkill. Did he go the same guy Donald Trump goes to? God damn. Next story.
Next story.
Something I'd be interested to check out is a new documentary on Shannon Hoon, the former lead singer of Blind Melon. It's entitled All I Can Say. And it's coming to virtual cinemas, whatever the fuck that is, record stores and music venues. What the fuck is a virtual cinema?
It's pretty much how I lure young girls into my van. I tell them I have a virtual theater in the car.
Oh, so it's a glory hole. Okay.
Right, yeah.
So coming to glory holes, record stores, and music venues. I'd like to check this out. You know, sad story. I mean, he died just, a couple blocks from my house. In his tour bus.
Why didn't you help him out?
I didn't live here then.
Where were you at the time? Here
then. He'd still be alive if I was here because I would have done all his fucking dope.
You'd have been over there bothering him. Hey, what are you doing? What are you doing? Why are you doing that?
Yeah,
huh? What's going on? Can you do say Diabolus and Podcastica?
Yeah. Give me another bump. Give me another bump. You can't do all that coke. You'll die.
What are you thinking?
Yeah. But I remember when they came out, I didn't really check him out. I mean, of course, like most people, I knew about him because he was in that fucking horrible Don't Cry video. And then they came out with the fucking B video. And you just couldn't escape that shit. It was on so much. And I just really, that song got on my last fucking nerve. So I never bought the album or anything. And I think I remember the video for Tones from Home, which wasn't a bad song, but I couldn't even see him without hearing that fucking B song, which oddly enough, I don't hate as much anymore. But at the time, boy, did I fucking hate that shit. But then I remember when they came out with the second album, Soup, and the first single was Galaxy. And I loved that song. I was like, fuck, now I'm going to have to check these guys out. And I bought Soup, and I thought it was fucking amazing. I still love that record. It's just a awesome, eclectic, all kinds of different shit on there. And got an all-new respect for them. And so I'd be interested in checking that out. Are you a fan of Blind Melon at all?
No, man. I like my metal heavy.
Oh, yeah. I forgot Blind Melon came out in the fucking 90s, too. Little before your time.
Oh, no. It came out right in my time. And I was very annoyed by the Blind Melon B video because it was always in the countdown to the ball at, like, number 4. And I'm like, get Blind Melon off Headbangers Ball. Like, get it out of here. I want some Carcass. I want some Obituary. I want some Cannibal Corpse. Get Blind Melon out. You can be in 120 minutes. See ya.
Yeah, you're cutting into my Days of the New Time. Get out of here with your B video. Oh, God.
I think you like Days of the New. This is the second time you brought them up. So I think we need to talk about this. Do you have Travis Meeks, fetish?
Yeah, you know his name, motherfucker. I just fucked him. I didn't remember his name. No, yeah, Days of the New, it's just, I don't know, it's just synonymous with a really shitty time in music, and I'll never forget just how much it annoyed me that Metallica had them open up. And that just, like, at a time when I was really hating Metallica, that made me hate them even more, because I'm thinking, you know, all these great bands that influenced you, or bands that you came up with that are really hurting right now, and you're taking out Days of the fucking New. You know, so they just, I'll never forget them, even though most people probably have forgot them. And they only had that one song, you know, or he only had that one song.
Yeah.
But I remember how much that it infuriated me when I saw, because for some reason, I think that bothered me even more than like when Limp Bizkit was opening up for Metallica, because by then I absolutely had no respect for him. You know, whatsoever at that time. But I remember the Days of the New was really, like, that was the final nail in the coffin. And I think that was around the Reload time, you know. And I'm just like, this is fucking pathetic. You know, help out your other metal bands that are struggling, you know. Nope. We chasing that radio money, yo.
Yeah, that was kind of a death knell for me, too, at the time. You know, I was just like, oh, God. Because the first time I saw him, I was just talking about this. I guess we were talking about this last week. But the first time I saw Metallica, it was Candlebox open for him. And I'm like, ah, get out of here. Get out of here with that crap.
Oh, yeah, that's just insane. And I think, like, even now, it's like, but the Metallica will do something like that, and then they'll do something as cool as like what they did for the 30th anniversary, where they had like, you know, hey, they get Mustaine, they get Ron McGovney, they get Merciful Fate to reunite, you know, they get fucking Armored Saint, Laz Rocket, all this shit, you know, it's like, wow, you do something so cool like that, but when you're doing a big major tour, you know. You love Merciful Fate so much, you do a Merciful Fate melody. Take them out as an opening band, man. Let them get a little taste of your mega fucking audience. Don't give it to these radio fucks that, you know, are already doing great. They're going to cash in on their one fucking album, you know.
But I will say that if there's a Shannon Hoon documentary coming out, I will watch it, because I will watch a documentary on any band. And then at the end of the documentary, I'll be like, you know what? I'll go back and check them out. And then I'll probably have my mind change. So I do love a good rock doc.
Yeah, I love documentaries in general. I like a lot, but I really love music documentaries, you know. I love all the dirt, you know, and shit like that, and the behind-the-scenes shit, you know.
Well, it looks like we got some breaking news here. As a part of today's The Metal Tour of the Year streaming event hosted by SiriusXM's Jose Mangan, Megadeth leader Dave Mustaine spoke about the progress of the recording sessions for the band's follow-up to Dystopia. He said Dirk and David Ellefson both have finished their parts, and this was probably one of the strongest records we've done. Blah, 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 blah. And then it goes on to say, it's up there with Countdown to Extinction, Rust in Peace, and probably Peace Sells. The only other one I would say is Dystopia, so it would round out my top five Megadeth albums.
Wow. That'd be amazing if it's true, but, I mean, don't you hear that from every artist?
That's what I'm saying. Like, this album is going to be the heaviest thing we have ever done, and it's, Reload.
Yeah, you're never going to see, Megadeth, talking about a new album. I'm going to put this up there with Risk and World Needs a Hero. What albums are sold the most? Oh, yeah, it sounds like that one, but I'm hoping, and I've mentioned this in previous episodes. Hey, I love Dystopia.
Oh, yeah, it's great.
And a great return to form. And I hope they go on that. And I mentioned before, I think it can go one or two ways. Of course, his cancer battle is going to come into play. But is it going to bring out like this awesome, anger and fuel in him, or is it going to be all reflective and you're going to get an album with like three Turd LeMond songs on it, that's what I don't want. But hey, man, they really shut me up with Dystopia. So if it can just compete with Dystopia, I'll be fucking happy. Let's be realistic. No matter what they put out, it's probably not going to shape me and be in the upper echelon with Rust in Peace or fucking Peace Sells or even So Far So Good So What. But if it can hold its own with Dystopia, I'll be happy. I'll be a fucking happy camper.
I think most bands at this point of their career, if this Megadeth album, like track one and two were bangers, and then they had eight more decent songs, people would rave about the album. I think that even as good as Hardwired is, I think you've got two solid tracks on it and then a lot of really, really good tracks. So as long as we can get one or two just classic Megadeth, hit you in the face Megadeth tracks, I think we're going to be fine.
Yeah, but I think they did better than that with Dystopia. I think Dystopia is a lot better than just two tracks. I think it's solid. I'm not saying every song is a stone cold classic, but I would say a good 70 to 75, maybe even 80% of that record, I think is fucking kick ass. And I'll still go back and listen to Dystopia. Which to me is a big sign at my age now for me to go back to a band's. I'm just being honest, because I'm still, man, I'm listening to new shit every day. I'm listening. I've been going through this phase a lot, like the last year or so, man. I'm listening to just a lot of new music, and not going back as much to the standards.
Yeah.
And for me to go back to Dystopia regularly, that says something, because I even went back when we were doing the Metallica. I had listened to Ride the Lightning so many times. Like, man, let me go back and listen to Hardwired. And I got to tell you the truth, going back, I didn't get through the whole thing. Of course, it's a long album, but that didn't even grab me as much as it did when it first came out,
Oh, yeah.
There's still, Spit Out the Bones, fucking, that's badass, But some of the other stuff, I was like, it's a little bit too rock and roll-y for Metallica. I like thrash Metallica, I don't like rock and roll-y Metallica. I don't like that fucking half-ass Molly Hatchet bullshit, I want thrash Metallica. But Megadeth delivered a thrash Megadeth album. So, fucking A. I hope they do it again. I'm happy Dave Mustaine's, supposedly in good health. I think that's awesome. And hopefully, we get tours again. And hell yeah. I want more than two good songs, goddammit. I want my money's worth.
What you got?
All right. Well, I'm going to get to somebody, the elusive other two songs you said, am I going to talk about? And that is the two songs that were released last Friday by Tommy Lee. Oh, holy moly. And I waited a couple days. You know, Baco put up a funny post about it. Baco from Cobras and Firecast, check it out. I was so bored at work the other day. I was like, fuck it. I'm going to check out these Tommy Lee songs. And wow. Wow, wow, wow. Even worse than I thought. Even fucking worse. I mean, holy shit. The two that I heard made that, you know, Hold Me Down song he had, or even Get Naked, sound like fucking Kashmir. And the funny thing is, Tommy's, I mean, there might be a little bit of background vocals, but it's two rappers.
Yeah.
And the only thing I can think of is that Tommy is, you know, programming the electronic drums, or he's the producer or something, so he's calling
it
Tommy Lee.
Yeah, he's been making
the
beats. You know, these are Tommy Lee beats, but these are, you know, he's got some vocalists on it.
Well, that's vocalist is kind of a fucking stretch. Holy shit, the one with the chick rapper, oh my god, and I don't know if she is like English or fucking Australian
or whatever. South African.
Oh my god. Like they don't have enough problems with blood diamonds and shit. They got to deal with rappers like that. Oh my god. That was bad. Although I will say, at least there was something about it. Just her accent made it better than the other guy. The other guy's was even worse. But these were two smoking turds. And just, I mean, all the proof that you need to know that if ever this tour, you know, the stadium tour does happen, it's all about money. Because I honestly believe, that's one thing I will say, I think this is what Tommy Lee likes now. I don't think he's been saying for years before Motley Crue ended, you know, that's, you know, he's making fun of Motley Crue music, and rightfully so. It's damn funny. But, you know, I don't know. It's like, I really think he's just somebody that's afraid to grow up, you know, and he's trying so hard to seem relevant. But it's getting worse and worse as he gets older. I don't know. Maybe that's really what he likes, but it just seems so desperate. Because it'd be one thing if it was like really good music, like it was experimental and it was new, but there was something like, hey, I hear something here. You know, it's not what I'm used to, but I hear something here. But this is just like, you know, it reminds me of stuff that's popular now, but like a C or D level of it, much like Motley Crue was, you know. But for some reason, hey, you know, Kiss is popular too. I don't know. It's just really, really sad. And, you know, it used to be, you know, when I was growing up, I was like, oh, man, I want to party with Tommy Lee. But really, all I want to do now is get arrested with Vince Neil. You know, I just want to go somewhere.
To a buffet with Vince Neil.
I want to go to a buffet with Vince Neil and watch him punch a woman, you know. And, you know, when he gets carted off, you know, then I'm going to help Mick Mars into his chair. And maybe we'll drink some whiskey. But I don't want to go nowhere near fucking Nikki Sixx or fucking Tommy Lee. Good Lord.
Yeah, I think of the two songs, I liked the girl rapper more. But I think a lot of it has to do with the accent, which I think was sexy as hell. But then also, she also reminds me of a rapper from like 2006 called Lady Sovereign. And I somewhat liked that back then, so it was kind of a, but I mean, still, that was 14 years ago, so it's just like, yeah, it's not current at all, but it's still, I liked the girl rapper more than the guy, and the guy just sounded too much like a somewhat of a rap metal song or something, but again, that's still something in Tommy's past, you know, with Methods of Mayhem, you know, you kind of had that rap metal side to him too, so I mean, you gotta. It's not too much of a departure of things that he's done in the past, but you put this out as Tommy Lee, and Tommy Lee's really not on it except for maybe some backing tracks here and there vocally. I think you're just going to confuse an entire fan base that does not want to hear what he's putting out.
Oh, yeah. I had an ex that met him around the time of Methods of Mayhem. And she said, she told him right to his face, you got to stop doing this shit and start playing some rock and roll. And she said he didn't like that too much.
I saw Methods of Mayhem a few times on that Ozfest that year. And
I can't remember. I think I saw him too at Ozfest. But, oh, my God, that shit was so bad. It was so bad. But I've never got the thing for Tommy Lee. I mean, I get, you know, chicks like him. Because he's tall, lanky, with a huge cock. I get why chicks like him, you know? But to me, he's always got this like thing like he's a drum god, and I never thought he was... I mean, I thought he was solid, but, you know, he's no fucking Bill Ward. He's no John Bonham. He's no Neil Peart. He's no fucking Stuart Copeland. But when you hear a Motley Crue record, it's like, you know, the producer turned up the drum tracks higher, so everybody thinks he's fucking great. But I've never got... But he's a character.
Yeah,
he's like... You know, he's Keith Moon without the talent. You know? I never heard any Motley Crue and like, wow, those drums blow me away, man. You know, it's just like, well, those drums are loud. You know, but it's... You know, God... To me, he's like a big dick Peter Criss, you know?
I think he does have a drum style that, you know, there's sometimes where you can be like, oh, that's Tommy Lee on drums, even when he's guested on other stuff. So, I mean, you kind of get what he does, you know, kind of king of the four on the floor type thing. But yeah, as a, you know, he's just a larger than life action figure with, he can drive a boat with his cock, you know.
You know, and you know, some people get offended. You know, I call him a big dick Peter Criss. You know, maybe Peter Criss got a big dick too. Maybe some of you guys going to that Ace Frehley concert can ask Ace, hey, how big is that dick you sucked of Peter Criss's?
That is one of the more bizarre things ever written in an autobiography, but yeah.
Ah! Nice dick, Curly. Nice dick, Curly.
All right, so we got the Tommy Lee stuff. So did you see I got some blabbermouth love today?
Oh, what is it, Friday? Jesus Christ, I see you on blabbermouth more than fucking Corey Taylor.
Yeah, well, Corey Taylor adjacent, so.
Yeah, I even see, like, I see it in the comments section, because I really, like, any time I want to hate humanity more, I read the comments on blabbermouth. And, you know, the new running joke is, yeah, but what does Josh Toomey have to say about it? You know,
and they used to say that about on Talk Toomey.
Yeah, they used to say that about Corey Taylor. But no, hey, I'm very proud of you, man. But let's talk about. Well, I mean, what you had like three or four this week, right?
Just the one this week. I had two last week, but let's see where I gotta find it. It's just so deep in here. All right, were you akin to any of this stuff in the '90s between Mushroom Head and Slipknot?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. So I had the drummer of Mushroomhead on to talk about their latest album, but
I saw Mushroomhead.
Oh, did you? How did you? What year? How long ago?
I want to say, I could be wrong, but I think I might have saw him with like Wasp, which is kind of weird. But you know, I saw some weird shows like that. I didn't think they were, you know, they weren't horrible. Not really my thing.
Never, I will say straight up, not a big fan. I've had the drummer on before, good conversation, got offered it again. And I was like, yeah, I'll take it again. And then a friend of the show, Jason T. Smith from Thrift Hunter's fame and whatnot, he was from Cleveland back in the day. So I asked him, you know, what if he had any questions about, you know, the old days of Mushroomhead. And he actually submitted a quote-unquote fan question, and it just kind of sparked the drummer Skinny from Mushroomhead to talk about kind of the feud between Mushroomhead and Slipknot. And basically his quote was, you know, they spent a lot of time complaining about Slipknot for nothing, because look at Slipknot now, they're one of the biggest bands in the world, and Mushroomhead's Mushroomhead. So yeah, man, it is definitely a chicken or the egg thing. You know, I had never heard of Mushroomhead before Slipknot, but technically, if you want to look at the history of the world, Mushroomhead came first, but Slipknot got signed first, and you know, they're very similar. And I still think it's kind of that shared thinking or whatever they call it. You know, the you know, two people have the same ideas at the same time in different venues. I don't think one ripped off the other.
Yeah, I mean, I think about them the same. You know, I'm not a huge Slipknot fan. I love Iowa.
Yeah,
I think Iowa's great. I mean, Iowa's like a fucking metal record. The first one's got a couple songs here and there. I don't mind. I mean, it's not really my wheelhouse, but they put on a good live show. I'll tell you that. I saw them live a couple times. They were pretty entertaining, but it's not something I put on a lot. But man, after Iowa, they really lost me. They really fucking lost me. And I even, Mr. X gave me the latest Slipknot. And I put it on my phone just so, you know, I knew it would pop up in a shuffle. And there's nothing I heard that fucking, you know, grabbed me at all. You know, so they're about what and what. But, it, you know, it's a shtick band.
Yeah.
You know?
Well,
let's be honest. I mean, what they were playing and then that style of music, what set them apart was the image. And if they didn't have that, you know, there's about a million other nu metal bands that sounded like them, you know, but they had the oddity of, there being 57 of them. I mean, I think there's more guys in fucking Slipknot than the Wu-Tang Clan, but Wu-Tang Clan ain't nothing to fuck with.
That is true. I've heard that from somebody.
And I'd actually rather listen to Wu-Tang Clan. But, there's bands that just, you know, get by on a gimmick. Kiss. You know.
But, yeah, I mean, I think that was the fun part of Slipknot when they first came out. I saw them probably two or three times on the first album cycle. You know, nobody knew what they looked like. Nobody knew who they were. Nobody knew the you know, it was definitely very similar to that Kiss thing where, you know, they didn't know their real identities and they didn't know what they really looked like. And then, yeah, you've got two guys playing percussion on stage. You got a left-handed bass player. You got, you know, the DJ and a keyboard player. And just like, I mean, I saw them at in Memphis opening for Machine Head and at what is that place called? It's on Bill Street. Can't think of the name of it off the top of my head. New Daisy Theater. And they, you know, they were the second band out of four, and they were set up, you know, all nine of them cramped on the front of the stage and just like going crazy. I mean, those early Slipknot shows were madness, you know. So I enjoyed the first album, you know, the early shows and stuff. So yeah, great times. And my thing with Mushroom Head is I think that maybe their costumes are actually cooler than Slipknot. But their music is nowhere near Slipknot, because I've never cared for that Jeffrey Nothing's voice, the one, the kind of the creepier, eerier voice that they have, because they have two singers. But they did replace him with a girl singer, and she actually is kind of cool sounding. So the new album, I was like, all right, not hating this one. But I could never really get past Jeffrey Nothing's voice.
Well, and a lot of people don't know, I don't talk about it, but much, but I was in an early incarnation of Slipknot, but I got tired of playing a tambourine in that fucking mask. It was just too fucking hot, you know.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
I mean, fuck it. You know, they had two guitar players, bass player, you know, drummer, you know, the guy scratching records. You had two bongo players, you know, and there was me on tambourine. And, you know, but it's too hot in that fucking mask. I said, fuck this shit. And there wasn't a lot of Slipknot songs featuring the tambourine at that time. So it's like, you know, most of the time I was just standing there in a mask, sweating my ass off. Fuck that shit.
Yeah, and now with the COVID-19 and the masks being kind of back around again, you're having like some PTSD.
Yeah. I'm wondering, they should have a resurgence now with all this mask shit.
Right. Some post-traumatic Slipknot disorder.
Yeah. I think they should come out in just like COVID masks. I think that would be cool. That would keep them, you know, popular and trendy.
Well, I think that's what, isn't that what Kiss wore in the 70s when they were trying to, you know, go from the limo to the club, you know?
Oh, God. I still say they stink. But enough of them. Something... I don't think we mentioned this on the last album. On the last episode. But I thought it's funny that Rats Round and Round is charting again. Did we talk about that last week?
Yeah, we talked about that.
Okay, never mind then. Fuck it. Let's get to the album.
Well, what do you think about Stryper to release a life-changing new single in 2 weeks?
Oh,
geez. Do you believe that that's going to happen?
Is it going to be good?
Yes.
You know? Oh, man. And I tell you, I kind of feel bad. Well, no, fuck it. I don't feel bad making fun of Stryper. But I will say Michael Sweet was a very nice guy.
Yeah, he was great.
He was a sweet guy, if you will.
Did you hang out with him at the bar after Rockin' Pod? Were you there?
No, not like you. No, I didn't get... But what's so funny is, so we had an interview with him, and my former co-host did not want me to be part of that interview because he thought that I would say something offensive to Michael Sweet, and he's a big Stryper fan, and he's like, oh, you're going to piss him off. You're going to... I don't want to do it with you, and he ended up doing it with Bushy from the Plug Podcast. And I was fine with that because I could give a rat's ass about Stryper anyway. But I was inebriated. Not as inebriated as apparently you were when you talked to him. But I was pretty buzzed and I said, hey, I made a joke about how I wasn't allowed to interview him because I would offend him. And I'd say, look, I'm not a big Stryper fan. And when I found out you were singing for Boston, I was like, oh my God, this is going to be terrible. Like, how the fuck can you replace Brad Delp? I go, but I'm going to be real honest with you. When I heard what you did with Boston, I go, you were incredible. So I want to give you, credit where credit's due. You did an amazing job. And he was totally cool about that. He didn't seem put off. I think he appreciated that I was honest, and he could tell that I was giving him a sincere compliment. I wasn't trying to blow, oh, yeah, I'm the biggest. I used to dress like a bumblebee, too. No, I just said, hey, I'm not a big fan, but you knocked it out of the park, which I stand by that. If anybody's, check out some of the clips of him singing Boston, which, I mean, Brad Delp from Boston is one of the most, unique and amazing voices. And I don't care if you like Boston or not, or you're burned out on him. That motherfucker had a voice, And when I heard him sing those songs, I was fucking impressed. And I told him, and he's like, hey, thank you. I appreciate it.
If you find yourself down the rabbit hole of Boston with Michael Sweet singing on YouTube, you need to reevaluate your life.
I drink a lot. But and I actually pissed right next to him, too, in the bathroom. And I thought that was funny.
I did that with... I looked over and Tony Harnell was in the bathroom when I was pissing at one point. I'm like, hey, Tony Harnell, Skid Row Zone. And he gave me a dirty look.
Yeah, I just looked at Michael Sweet, nodded, and he's like, hey, nice cock,
Right.
And I was like, thank you, Michael Sweet. I don't think this new song is going to change the world.
I don't know. You never
just
know.
That's my personal opinion. But hey, I ain't going to lie. I do like the song To Hell with the Devil, and that's about it that I've ever heard.
That was one band I've never cared for, throughout the years. And then that latest album, the Goddamn Evil, I thought was actually pretty cool.
A lot of people told me that, Ralph used to tell me, oh, check out the new, there was a song called Yahweh or Jawa or fucking Yahweh or I'm Gay, some shit like that. He's like, oh, check it out. And I was like, okay. The way you're talking about it must be pretty good. Did fucking nothing for me. Didn't do a fucking thing for me, and I tried. I gave it a fucking day in court.
Nice.
But I don't know. I just it's weird. I don't like the way he sings, But when he does Boston, it was fucking awesome. But his voice in Stryper, I don't really care for. Now I did hear some tracks on the first album he did with George Lynch.
Yeah.
And I thought that wasn't bad. And I have both albums. I never even listened to the second one. I heard bad things about it. I heard it was nowhere near as good. But even the shit with George Lynch, I mean, let's be... I only listen to it because it's fucking George Lynch on guitar, and I think he's fucking amazing. But it was passable,
Were you at the Rockin' Pod pre-party when he did the... Didn't he do Judas Priest?
Yeah, but for most of that night, I was outside smoking, man. Because when I drink, I have to smoke. That's why I never go to bars anymore. That's why I just drink at home like a fucking loser. And you know, even though I smoke a douche flute, you know, I don't have a, you know, I don't smoke, I haven't smoked real cigarettes in fuck almost 8 years, but you know, I got to hit my douche flute and a lot of places won't let me do that. So I spent the majority of that. I remember I started watching it and then the fucking cover band started doing some Sammy Hagar shit. And it was so funny because it's like the whole room of podcasters turned and looked at me. Yeah. As I was walking away, you know, yep. I'm just like,
I think you just waved and you were gone.
Yeah, I did. I waved. I'm like, I'm out of here. And then it's just, you know, I mean, you know how those rock and pods go, man. It's just a parade of cool people and fucking rock stars and shit. So I was more than happy to hang out there getting drunk and smoking, you know.
Nice.
But apparently I did miss a lot of cool shit, you know.
Yeah, it was fun. It was a good time. Chris Sinzak knocked it out of the park.
As he does every year.
Yes, he does. All right, so album of the week. Review.
Oh, yeah. And this is one, you know, we talked about last week. We were going to go back to my idea of, you know, the stuff we hate. And I got to tell you, even though we postponed it a week, I still didn't know if I was ready for that or that kind of negativity. Not like I'm a fucking fountain of fucking positivity this week. But, you know, I was still like... You know, I was really in the back of my head. I'm thinking, we really just need to talk about an album. And you know, when I sent it to you, it was kind of like a, you know, an underhand pitch. I was like, "What are we doing this week?" And you're like, "The hate episode." And I was like, "Okay." And then you're like, "Or White Zombie?" You know, and I was like, "Yes." Yes, and then I was like, "Which album?" And you're like, "You pick." I'm like, "Oh fuck yeah, I'm going with Sexorcisto."
Meanwhile, behind the facade of this innocent-looking bookstore.
Swinging sounds or whatever, the swinging sexy sounds of White Zombie.
Yeah, fuck that remix shit. No, we're going with, in my opinion, I know there's a lot of people that disagree with me, but they drink craft beer and have beards. You know, they say that Astro Creep is the better album. I disagree.
Well, I disagree. I agree with those people, but...
Yeah, I figured you would. I make so many assumptions about you and I'm wrong, but I knew you were going to say Astro Creep, but there's just the rawness of this. Yeah. I think this was the perfect mix of White Zombie because the albums prior to this, which I hadn't heard at that point, but I went back and searched out, were just too raw.
Unlistenable.
And too underproduced. You know, I don't think there was a producer, just somebody who hit record, you know, on a realistic tape deck they got from Radio Shack.
Yeah.
But this one, to me, had the perfect mix, you know, the punk element, the groove metal element, had all the same. I mean, to me, when I first got into White Zombie, and I got to give props to Matt Thiessen and Bo Handy, and I've talked to them about them on my other show. These guys really, they had their pulse on the underground. They were like the coolest kids that knew shit before it got big. These were the guys that turned me on to Pantera before they got big, turned me on to White Zombie. They're like, check this out. And, man, when I heard this, it was like a comic book coming to life. It was so cool. And at a time when it was really needed, because when this came out in early, 92, you know, fucking cock rock was all but dead and gone. And the cock rock that was coming out was shit like fucking Steelheart, you know, and tough and fucking bitch shit like that. Danger, danger, fucking crap, you know, shit that made fucking Dokken sound like Slayer. So that, you know, the cock rock that I loved was going away. It was so shitty and watered down. You had the grunge coming up, which I liked some of it, but it was so anti-cock rock. I didn't like that it swung too much the other way. You know, it's like I wanted to change, but I wanted it to still be heavy and cool. And man, White Zombie was fucking heavy and cool. And I think in the early 90s, you could have pointed at two better bands than them and Pantera. And it's so awesome that they toured together. You know, what a great tour that was.
Yep, definitely saw that tour.
But, you know, two bands that, you know, sound nothing alike, but it was something that was fresh and needed. I mean, you had shit. I mean, there was definitely elements, like I could hear some Ministry in White Zombie, you know, like with the samples and the shit like that. And it had groove, like Pantera had groove. But it was also hard, too. And you had, you know, the videos and the artwork. And there was just, it really, to me, it is. It's like a comic book, a horror comic come to life.
Yeah.
And it was just so, so badass. And I love this band. I got to see him. I think I saw him two or three times on this tour. And it was just amazing. It is really good. And I've been listening to this album so much the last, well, since you told me we were doing it, the minute you told me we were doing this, I was on my way home from work and I put the album on, and I can't believe how good it holds up. I mean, everything from the songs to the production, doesn't sound dated at all. Sounds just as fresh. And it's, to me, White Zombie's the best shit Rob Zombie ever did. I still like some of his solo shit, not all of it, but I still like it. And he still puts on a great show if you go see him live. You know, he's got an amazing band. You know, fucking John Five is a beast. Ginger Fish is a great drummer. I forget it. I don't know. Is Blasco playing bass for him now? I don't even know anymore.
No, it's Piggy D.
Oh, Piggy D. Yeah.
You know, this album, I was actually going to ask you about it because I was listening to it today, and you know, this album came out, I was 13, but I remember getting into it pretty well right as it came out. You know, it was all over Headbangers Ball, the Thunderkiss 65 video, and then even Black Sunshine, you know, kind of comes out, and both of those tracks just made me fall in love with the band. But I'm still kind of new to metal at the time. So this wasn't like this was just like what's going on. But I mean, you know, someone like you that had been into metal since the 80s, you know, a band like this comes along, does it not kind of shock the senses, or was it just kind of a nice progression what did they do to you?
Oh, yeah. You know, because I was 18 when this came out, you know, well, I was just about ready to turn 18. And, like I said, it was such a weird time because, you know, as I mentioned already, cock rock was dying a miserable death. You know, like you're seeing Nelson on Headbangers Ball, you know, but you're also seeing Nirvana, which I didn't mind. I mean, I liked Nirvana because it was, I mean, for somebody who was around back then, Nirvana was a breath of fresh air because cock rock was getting so pussified. But at the same time, you know, I want those guitar solos that you're not getting from a fucking Pearl Jam album, you know? And I wanted something dirty and satanic. And here you go. You know, because really by 92, you still had, you know, I had turned a lot to thrash because cock rock had gotten so bad. But this was just, it was different. It was, I mean, it really, you felt, there was so much new shit happened because grunge was new, you know? But this was a new, you know, not new metal, but
like
you know what I mean?
A different take on metal.
Yeah, a different, the same way Pantera was, man. You know, because Pantera was, it wasn't, I still don't really hear it as thrash, but it was definitely heavier than everything else. You know what I mean? It wasn't like thrash. I don't know. It kind of was, but it was just, Pantera was different, and White Zombie was different. It just, it felt like kind of how you talk about how you embrace nu metal because it was of your time and stuff.
Yeah.
I felt like this was something. Pantera and White Zombie were something that was really interesting that was happening in my time. I was also listening to a lot of Prong around this time. That's another band that Matt and Bo turned me on to. And, you know, and you had, you know, Faith No More in 92 would go out to put Angel Dust, which was a game changer. There was... It was just different, and it felt special, and really, and it was neat to be a part of, you know. And I'm at that weird age where I'm old, you know. I got a car, and I can go out and do stuff myself, and I can go to shows whenever I want. But I still can't get into bars, you know. But this was like my music.
Oh yeah,
and I love that. But this album in particular, to me, has the best sound. I do love Astro Creep. I think it's great, and I love John Tempesta as a drummer, and I'm friends with him on Facebook. He's a really nice guy. He is a solid drummer. He's played on a lot of great albums. He does amazing drums on the Testament album, Low.
Oh, yeah.
And he's done great shit with The Cure. I mean, he's played with a lot of people. But I gotta say, when it comes to White Zombie, I'm all about Ivan on drums. I think Ivan just had like a different sound. The band was complete with this lineup with Jay and Sean and Ivan. And I know if I say this, it's going to sound horrible because he's a better drummer than that. But it's almost like he's the Matt Sorum of White Zombie.
Okay.
You know, he's a much better drummer than Matt Sorum. But it's more of like a more polished pedestrian version on Astro Creep. I don't know. It's just too polished and kind of a symbol of what was to come with Rob Zombie's solo career. Like, this is the White Zombie sound for me, is Sexorcisto.
So who's your more favorite Tempesta? Is it John with White Zombie or Mike with Power Man 5000?
Oh, John all the way. John all the way. Nothing against Mike. I saw him with Power Man. But same thing with Mike Tempesta's era of Power Man. I like Stars Revolt, but it's a little bit too polished, a little bit too radio-friendly. I like the fucking whatever the fuck Mega Kung Fu Radio was. I mean, that was just a weird, awesome. I kind of compare those. It's almost the same thing. Like, Astro Creep was definitely the bigger album, and Stars Revolt was bigger for Power Man, but I think they were in a more pure form. And it's just like Guns N' Roses. To me, pure Guns N' Roses is Appetite for Destruction.
Yeah.
And Use Your Illusions is just too fucking, you're trying too hard. You know, and there's good, and trust me, Astro Creep is miles above Use Your Illusions 1 and 2 combined, and fucking Tonight the Stars Revolt. But it's the same thing. It's like moving in. It's like going too far too fast. Where this album seems natural. Appetite seemed natural. Mega Kung Fu seemed natural.
Yeah. This album, man, I love the samples throughout it. You know, all the old horror movies and all that. And then the imagery that Rob is a complete artist, man. His artwork on the album, the way the band looks, you know, they look like rock stars, you know, and then you've got Sean in the band, which is never going to hurt you as a rock band, having a nice looking female bass player like that. And so, I mean, it was just so much fun to go and see like live like that. Honestly, I think it's the next album, but the Pantera White Zombie tour, Like they pulled out all the stops on that white zombie for White Zombie, man. Like Pantera got up there, played their stuff. There was some fire and all that nonsense, and then White Zombie comes out, and there's, you know, go-go dancers and fucking set changes and, you know, just so much stuff going on, man. And as a kid watching that stuff, man, you're just like completely blown away by the absolute size of the production of the band.
Oh, and they held their own, man. I mean, that was still one of the best shows I've ever saw. Was that when it was Deftones, Pantera, and White Zombie?
Yeah, we got I Hate God, but yeah.
It, like, how do you follow fucking Pantera? And I'm not going to say White Zombie was better than Pantera, but they held their fucking own.
Yeah, that was one of those things where I think that the only reason that they went after Pantera was just the sheer size of the stage show.
Oh, man. Oh, yeah. And I mean, that's, you know, it's like seeing White Zombie on the Astro Creep tour was like when I saw Manson on the Mechanical Animals tour. Like, right. Yeah, like, you know, if you want to get technical, his peak was Antichrist, but he actually had more money and a bigger stage show for Mechanical Animals. And still, Mechanical Animals, I'll take that over any Kiss tour that I saw. I mean, one of the best, like, stadium shows.
Yeah.
I've never seen anything come close to that Mechanical Animals tour.
Well, Manson live, seeing Manson live is what sold me on Manson. I enjoyed Portrait of an American Family, but I didn't really get into it. But then I went and saw him on Antichrist Superstar, and the stage show with the, you know, when he's up at the podium singing with the, you know, right, where he had the little lightning bolt tail instead of the Nazi symbols come down. And I mean, at one point the arena was snowing. You know, I mean, it was much stuff going on, man. And it was just an absolute kind of just return to that gigantic stage show that had been missing in rock and roll.
Oh, yeah, and don't get me wrong, I'm a huge Manson fan. I'm not saying Manson is the best band that I've ever seen live.
Right.
But I'm just saying, as far as a stage show, you know, because by the time I was coming, you know, I was at that weird age where, you know, I didn't get to see Iron Maiden on the fucking Live After Death tour, or, you know, Dio on the Last in Line tour, these, like, epic tours with huge stage shows that, you know, are the stuff of legend.
Why not, you know? Poser?
Because I was like 10, you know? Yeah. It was hard enough to get my grandpa to take me to go see Purple Rain at the movie theater, you know? But, you know, it's one of those things where, like, the metal that I loved was getting pushed down into the clubs. And it was cool because I got to get close to all these people. But I didn't get to see the big productions, you know. That shit was kind of going away. And the rare, you know, you could see Pantera in a fucking arena, you know. You could see White Zombie in an arena at that time. But everything else was a fucking club show. Which, I mean, has its place, but to see that kind of big production, and White Zombie just put on an amazing show. But those shows that I saw, you know, all the shows that I saw on this tour, I believe I saw him at the Aragon in Chicago. I saw him at the Riv, or maybe twice at the Riv. But I mean, and I saw him. I can't remember if I got to see him with Ivan or not. They had this dude before Tempesta. His name was Philo or Philo. I know I saw him for sure, because that was a night I was hanging out with Jay, the guitar player. Me and my buddy were hanging out with his dad. we saw this old dude, like, I forget who the opening band was. I think it was Quicksand or some shit like that, and we didn't really care for him. So we're walking around drinking beer, and we see this old dude at the show. We're like, hey, what's up, man? He's like, hey, you kids enjoying the show? We're like, oh, yeah, when White Zombie comes on. And he's like, oh, that's my boy's band. We're like, what? He's like, oh, Jay's my son. And nice. And he was the nicest guy, and from what I found out later, because I'm also friends with Jay's nephew, that, you know, he died shortly after that, like a year or two after that. But such a nice guy.
Wow.
You know, and then when I came to New Orleans, You know, me and my buddy, we were like stalkers. We're like, we got to get into the New Orleans music scene, find out where all the right bars are. And Sean and Jay owned a bar here in town called The Saint. The bar is still here, but they don't own it anymore. And I actually fixed the jukebox at the bar. And I remember we used to go there just hoping we'd see Sean or Jay. And we go there one night, and it's one of the rare nights at that point in my life that I got high, because I kind of quit smoking weed. But I was good and drunk. I said, fuck it, smoke some weed. So I walk into The Saint, just fucking, you know, I'm so high. I'm paranoid as a motherfucker. And the bartender's like, Ian, I'm like, huh? What? What'd I do? Huh? What? And she's like, Jay wants to talk to you. And I'm like, what? Jay's here? He wants to talk to me? Oh, fuck. What'd I do? I'm fucking so paranoid. And he's like, you the guy who fixed the jukebox? I was like, yeah. He's like, you're like fucking Yoda and shit. I was like, right on, man. He's like, let me buy you a drink. And I was like, cool. So I'm thinking I'm going to hang out with Jay and shit, you know, and he had like two hot chicks with him. I was like, this is going to be awesome. And then it was clear, you know, real soon that, there's your drink. Now get the fuck out of here so I can right. So I can get with these chicks. But I was so high, I was almost like thankful. Like, okay, let me get the fuck out of here before I make an ass out of myself.
So when you say you fixed the jukebox, do you mean that you just went and took all the Sammy Hagar out of it?
Oh, no. Oh, my God. They had the best jukebox. There was two, like, amazing jukebox in town. One was the one that was at the Saint that Jay and Sean owned. And then there's the one right by my house, Le Bon Tom's, which Pepper Keenan owns. Oh, my. You couldn't ask for a better fucking jukebox with a great mix of, like, just classic metal and classic rock and not a shit CD on it. So, no, there was no Sammy Hagar on it. And when I say fix the jukebox, I'm really kind of bragging on myself because it wasn't working, but it's because the wires weren't hooked up right. And I'm an electrician.
It wasn't plugged up.
Yeah, I pulled it back, and I noticed the wires were kind of loose, so I, like, fixed them, and then everybody at the bar is happy because the jukebox working, and I kept bragging about it all night, and the bartender, Squirrel's like, so what'd you do? So I told her, and she's like, that was it? And I was like, yeah, but I fixed it. You know, and then the drunker I get, the more I brag about, you know, what a genius I am for fixing the jukebox. And she's like, yeah, whatever, genius. She goes, I can fucking plunge a toilet. Don't make me a plumber. We're dying laughing.
Nice.
But, you know, and then, you know, probably about a year after that, I ended up, like, drunk. And I shit you not, a Scooby-Doo van. A van painted just like the Scooby-Doo van. And
that's always how a good night starts.
Oh, no, this is how the night ends.
Okay.
But I'm drunk as shit, and I'm in the Scooby-Doo van with Sean and her husband. And I'm just like, I'm drunk as shit thinking like, God, if you would have told me when I was 18 that I would be fucking drunk as shit in New Orleans in a Scooby-Doo van with Sean from White Zombie, you know, like, holy shit. And she's so nice. I've hung out with her a couple times, and she signed a copy of Sexorcisto for my son.
Nice.
And his grandmother threw it away because she thought it was satanic.
Yeah.
Oh, and he's really not still far pissed. Off. He's still pissed about that. I was like, well, you know, you're 27 now. I can get you another one. I can get her to sign it and, you know, don't let your grandma see it. But, no, just a great band and cool people. Well, Jay and Sean are cool. I never got to meet Ivan or John Tempesta. I never met Rob. I saw Rob, and I was really pissed at him at Ozfest because it was a year they were, Zombie was playing and Down was playing, and I had paid to meet Down and get their autograph, but it was postponed for so long because Zombie had to sign first, and he was taking his sweet-ass time. And I can't remember who the band was, but I was pissed because I paid money to meet fucking Down, but I wanted to see a band that was on stage, and everything's getting fucked up because Rob Zombie's taking his sweet-ass time pulling some rock star shit coming out. So I'm in line, and I saw Zombie, and I'm just like, fuck you! Fuck you. White zombie's better, you know, which I still believe. But this album, I mean, holy shit.
Yeah, great one.
I mean, has my favorite White Zombie song of all time, which is the opening track, Welcome to Planet Motherfucker / Psychoholic Slag. Thunderkiss, Black Sunshine, Grindhouse of Go-Go. I've got great memories of being in the pit for that at the Riv. This small little, like, dank-ass theater, but I love it. And just, I mean, that place was going insane. It's a small stage, and the way he would dance around, and the pit was going insane. I mean, Warp Asylum, I Am Legend, Cosmic Monsters. I mean, the album is just, it's incredible. It's incredible. And, like I said, I think it's one that really holds up.
Yeah, I listened to it today while mowing the yard, and I was like, man, this is actually a really, really good album.
Yeah, and like I said, I love Astro Creep too, but it's just, it's a little bit more refined, and the drumming, I don't like as much. And again, I like him as a drummer, but it's,
yeah,
you know, sometimes, you know, a band has a chemistry because a band comes together. And then when they replace them with somebody, a lot of times it's not so much about chemistry as they want somebody who's dependable, you know. But the guy who was there first, he put his own stamp on it, you know. He did what he wanted to do.
Right.
Now the new guy comes in and he does what he does to a certain level, but it's kind of like, okay, do what this guy did, you know. Like it's like Tommy Thayer, you know, going up there, you know. I'm not saying, I'm you know, I'm not comparing Tempesta to Tommy Thayer, but you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
When you join an already established band, you're kind of obligated to keep, you know, the old sound, and you can do a little bit of yours, but 9 times out of 10, it never has the spontaneity because you don't have the pull that an original band member does. You know, usually original band member can say, no, that's what I'm laying down. Where if you're the new guy, you're going to do what the rest of this band that's already selling records is going to do, you know? Does that make sense?
Oh, yeah. You know, I was actually listening to an interview with Gary Holt today, and he was talking about how when he joined Slayer, he didn't learn Jeff Hanneman's guitar solos note for note. He's like, that's for a tribute guy. He's like, if there are certain phrases that are kind of memorable, then he'll play those. But for the most part, he played his own solos on the classic Slayer stuff. And I was like, wow, that's a... But he was very defiant about it. He's like, yeah. He's like, I'm going to play it like I'm going to play it. You know, he's like, I could never play it as well as Jeff type stuff.
But yeah, you know what I mean? He had the carte blanche to do that because he's fucking Gary Holt.
True.
You know, and even though they didn't have the record sales, you know, everybody in that band respected Gary Holt.
Yeah.
You know? And, you know, I saw Slayer, you know, a couple of times with Gary Holt, and it was amazing. And I love that he did his own thing. I mean, he didn't, like, you know, it wasn't to where, like, you know, I'm going to show you who I am. I mean, he kept it faithful, but he also was faithful to himself. And that made it even better to me. You know, it's like, fuck, nobody can replace Hanneman, but at least you're going to do it and not go the tribute fucking route, you know, not go the Tommy Thayer fucking route. You know,
yeah.
But I mean, really, if you go see Kiss, do you want to hear it sound like Ace Frehley, or do you want to hear it sound like fucking Black and Blue? Yeah, you want to hear it sound like that. but with Slayer's, you know, music that's a little bit more, you know, definitely heavier and more integrity, and he's just an amazing guitar player in his own right. So, did you see Slayer with Gary Holt?
Yeah, I saw him a few times with him. Great every time. Yeah, it was fantastic every time we saw him, man. It was I loved it, man. Kind of going back to this album though, my last thoughts on this album, La Sexorcisto, Devil Music Volume 1, is man, I remember freshman year of high school, my friend Doug was a couple of years older, we lived in the same apartment complex, so he drove to school, and he had this old Ford Tempo that had a cassette deck with these. He listened to everything on 12 and had blown speakers. They sounded like shit, but man, he absolutely loved this album, and we listened to it every day on the ride to school at like 1,000, the volume up to 1,000, And that's what I always think about this album, is I think of those car rides to school and that fucking Ford Tempo.
Well, you know, and I like that you said when you listened to it today, you know, you remembered how good it was. Because I got to admit, I did buy this on vinyl a couple years ago and played it. And I loved it. I highly recommend that. If you can get the, I think it's a 180 gram music on vinyl, was the record label that put it out. It's a really good pressing. It sounds great. But this is one that I kind of went years without listening to. And I think that more had to do with, you know, as Rob Zombie's career kind of, you know, those albums were getting worse and worse. I was like, I ain't listening to that shit anymore. But going back to it now, like, man, I forget how awesome it was.
But I will say, you had the same. I will say, I went to Riot Fest a few years ago, the year that the Misfits played, and the big selling point was the Misfits reunion. Why Rob Zombie was going to play Astro Creep 2000 start to finish. And then there were a few other bands. I mean, there was just bands all day long that I wanted to see. Was certain, you know, they were playing right. This album or it was a final show. But it was funny that they played Astro Creep 2000 in its entirety. It was amazing. I fucking loved it. And then they had time for like two more songs, and they did Dragula. And when they and I thought the crowd was going nuts, and then they kicked into Dragula. The fucking place blew up. And I was like, really? Like, Rob Zombie's Dragula is better than anything off of fucking Astro Creep 2000? Well, it was crazy how much people loved Rob Zombie versus White Zombie there.
Well, you know, he made a comment in some interviews, and I thought he was absolutely full of shit, but you're kind of backing up what he said. He said, you know, he plays, you know, of course he's always going to play Thunderkiss and Black Sunshine. You know, and More Human Than Human, stuff like that. But he's saying these songs that he think would get a bigger response, you know, he gets bigger response with his solo shit. And, you know, you just backed up what he said.
It was nuts.
But I think that speaks in volumes to the audience. I think you got a lot of people there, like, you know, Dragula was all over the fucking radio. And I love it. It's a great song, but it's not as good as White Zombie,
right?
In my opinion.
Me too. I 100% agree with that.
But it's more, you can't lie. It's more popular and it's more accessible, you know. And it's this chicks, man. Chicks love fucking Rob Zombie solo shit. Chicks love Rob Zombie like they love Type O Negative, you know. Like all the chicks love Type O, and chicks really get into Rob Zombie. But I've noticed, like, chicks get more into his solo shit because it is more, you know, he would go more that kind of like what Static X called themselves, evil disco.
Yeah.
You know, especially with the second solo album he did, a lot more like dance beats to it and stuff. And it got way away from the White Zombie sound that I loved, you know. But I could see that going over bigger. But, you know, I saw him the last time he came through New Orleans, and he still put on an amazing show. I mean, the way that guy moves around the stage, I guess there's something to be said for being a vegetarian. You know, you don't get fat and old, you know, he's in his 50s in great shape. And he was dancing around on stage like, you know, he was in his early 20s, you know, and he's got, like I said, he's got a tight band now, but it doesn't have that White Zombie sound. And I know, because I saw White Zombie so many times, I know the magic of that band and the chemistry that they had, you know, and they had their own unique sound. And I mean, it might sound like a weird contradiction, but it's like the band he's got now sounds too good, if you know what I mean. It doesn't have that rawness, you know, that different feel that made White Zombie so special. But great pick, man. Great. I'm so glad you picked this. And, you know, I would love to talk about Astro Creep on another, you know, future episode, but this is one I really wanted to hear. And I hope people go back and, you know, if you haven't listened to this in years, man, go back and check this fucker out, man, because I think you'll enjoy it just as much as you and I have.
Yeah, it was fun. It was fun to go back and listen to today. Absolutely agree with that. All right.
Awesome.
Well, how about a little bit of a little something old, something new? What you got?
Something new.
All right. Well, my something old this week comes from another band that, you know, they don't, I don't know. They sound nothing. I kind of put them like hand in hand, like I can listen to either one. And that is the Cramps. I love the fucking Cramps. Are you familiar with them at all?
I mean, probably just the hits.
Yeah, the hits. They weren't really a hit band, but definitely have
there's
stuff.
A hit. Let me look at this. There's a hit.
But well, I'm going to give you the hit album because I think it's well, the closest thing they had to a hit album was a greatest hits. Much kind of like the way a lot of people discover the Misfits through that, you know, the first collection CD, the one with the yellow cover and stuff that's got all the great songs. Well, the Cramps have theirs, and they had it first with 1984's Bad Music for Bad People.
Nine to six eyes, I got a garbage brain that's driving me insane. And I don't like a ride, so push that best aside. And baby, I won't care, cause baby, I don't scare, cause I'm a reborn maggot.
And, oh my God, this is so good. I got turned on to this in the eighth grade. A guy named Paul Turngren turned me on to this and Saxon. Strong Arm of the Law. He's like, you need to check out these two albums, and both of them, I couldn't be more thankful for being turned on to them. And funny side note is after White Zombie, Sean would go on to play bass for the Cramps for a short period of time. I believe actually up until Lux's death, I believe she was the final bass player in the band. But
on a side note, I did see Sean's side band Famous Monsters twice. So
I never saw Famous Monsters. I saw her with Rock City Morgue.
Nice.
A band she had with Rick Phantom here. And actually, the night that I ended up in the Scooby-Doo van, it was Rock City Morgue and her husband's band, Supergroup. Chris Lee's band with his brother Benji Lee. They haven't done anything recently. But it was such a great show, really good night. And like I said, Sean's so fucking cool. But man, how cool is that? She played for White Zombie and the fucking Cramps. And I know there's probably a lot of people don't know the Cramps, but check it out, man. It's psychobilly. It's a mixture of punk and old school rock and roll. You can take fucking Elvis and shove that shit up your ass sideways with a fried banana fucking sandwich. Fuck that. But this fucking Elvis got nothing on Lux Interior, man. Holy shit. What a fucking front man. And just this song just oozes. All these songs ooze fucking like sex and punk and rock and roll. And I mean, just classic songs. Goo Goo Muck, She Said, Garbage Man, New Kind of Kick, Human Fly, Drug Train. I mean, 11 tracks and not a bad one. I mean, yes, it's a compilation. I get that. But, I mean, just incredible good time rock and roll. If you want to listen to this, I mean, this to me is, I mean, it's just real rock and roll. I think this is an album you should check out. Go back, put this on next time you're cutting the grass. Put on Bad Music for Bad People. One of the most iconic record covers, too. I mean, just that like zombified face on there with the bright yellow and everything.
Yeah.
An amazing band. And I think I might have previously on my old show had this as a pick of the week, but apparently enough of you didn't listen because... still the number one selling album is Eagles Greatest Hits Volume 1, and I never picked that shit. You know, let me see the Cramps Bad Music for Bad People enter the charts again like fucking Rat Round and Round. That would make me happy. That would be, and they deserve it. A great band. And, you know, they've got a lot more than this and a lot of great albums, but this is just like that collection of the Misfits is, you know, for them. It's a great starting point. You know, get that. You know, this is the shit that'll get you hooked. This is the gateway drug. And then you go check out the albums. But before I move on, I wanted to go back to what you were talking about earlier. I didn't know you went to Riot Fest. How was the Misfits? Was it awesome?
Yeah, it was just one of those, like...
Are you a big Misfits fan?
Oh, yeah. I mean, that was the main reason we went, was because, you know, of the reunion. I didn't know how many they were going to do. It was the second show they did. They did one in Denver and then one in Chicago, like how you like to say it. You know, that's the only time you really hear your Chicago accent is when you say the word Chicago.
Chicago.
Like, there's like an R in there. So Chicago.
Chicago.
but it was great. It was a lot of fun, man. It was cool to see them live and playing together.
It wasn't sad. It sounded good.
I thought it sounded fine. I mean, it was, you know, Glenn's, 100 years old, but, you know, it was cool to see them play again. You know, obviously I know all of the tension in the band throughout the years and stuff. So I knew the significance of what I was seeing and, it was great.
God, did you hear the new fucking, the Danzig Sings Elvis album?
Yes, I did. I did not like it.
Oh, man. And I'm kind of predisposed because I fucking hate Elvis. I hate Elvis with a passion. I don't like his songs. I don't like his songs that he didn't even write. I am a Chuck Berry, Little Richard guy. Carl Perkins. Give me that shit. All of the fucking... Jerry Lee Lewis. Give me all Jerry that Lee. Shit over fucking Elvis. But I was like, I'll check it out because... I love Danzig so much. And, you know, I liked the cover of Trouble he did. I was like, sounds better than Elvis. But, oh, my God, was that album bad. Woofa.
Yeah, he did, he almost, you know, he did a lot of, like, obscure Elvis songs, too. It wasn't like he did, like, Elvis, you know, it wasn't like Danzig sings the hits. It was very much a deep track.
And he gets a very special beard, and a fucking neck tattoo and a nose ring, for being hipster about, you know, picking the non-obvious tracks. But that's one thing that I was hoping would be a saving grace, because I don't want to hear fucking Hound Dog. You know, I don't want to hear that fucking shit. But I didn't want to hear the other shit he sang either. Oofa. How about putting out a good Danzig album with Erie Vaughan and Chuck Biscuits and John Christ? That would sound good about right now. God damn Danzig lets me down. But I will say this, it wasn't as bad as that movie he put out.
I've yet to see the movie. I'll have to check it out.
Oh, no, don't, dude. Don't. You know, a lot of times, I just to be an asshole, I'd say, oh, check it out. But no, that is... time in your life that you will never get back. I mean, really, really, don't waste that time. That movie is that bad. That I'd rather watch The Room again than fucking watch that shit. I mean, it is one of the worst things I've ever seen in my life. I'd rather watch a Police Academy movie without Steve Guttenberg than that shit. Oh my God, it's bad.
So for my something old. You know, it's funny, man. The Mooger Fugger was over on the Decibel Geek podcast a couple of weeks ago, and I was catching up with it, and it was refreshing because I believe he's older than both of us, but he was actually talking about very current bands and being into them, and I reached out to him. I was like, you know what? It's kind of refreshing to hear somebody that's into the 80s metal, but also still keeps up with what's going on today. And he was saying that one of his favorite bands was Coheed and Cambria. And they have an amazing album that came out in 2005 called Good Apollo, I'm Burning Star 4, Volume 1, From Fear Through the Eyes of Madness.
Could not be all I wanted, but you were enough.
yeah, it's got the big hit on it's a welcome home. You know, it's very proggy. Kind of, if you like Geddy Lee's voice, you'll probably enjoy Claudio's voice. But man, it's just a great album. I've seen them live a couple of times. Great band live. And so I think for my something old would be some Coheed and Cambria from 2005.
Yeah, I bought that album when it came out. I really liked that single. I thought it was really good. But I need to listen to the album more. I think I listened to it all the way through only once. And it wasn't like that fucking Avenged Sevenfold album I bought where everything else was absolutely wretched. But God, that album was so bad. But just nothing that grabbed me. But that's something I definitely need to go back and give another listen to. I'm going to listen to that one song tonight because I really like that. Was it Welcome Home? That was the video and the single.
That was
a really good song. Very, very catchy. Okay, well, you're something old, yeah. Yeah, I think Kenneth Waugh was right about you not liking anything older than 12 years. But but yeah, wow, way to go back into the vaults on your something old.
You know, it's all funny, right, every time I go for my something old, it's like, released in 1993. It was a great year.
Yeah.
It's like, I'm trying something. I'm mixing it up, man. Creedence Clearwater to Coheed and Cambria, right?
My something new this week isn't an album, isn't a movie, but something that was, I don't know, I think it was advertised as a comedy special, but not a lot of comedy in it, and that's the new Dave Chappelle special that was just released last night at midnight.
So the other night, I'm in my little clubhouse, and I'm watching Don Lemon, that hotbed of reality. He says, where are all these celebrities? Why aren't you talking? This nigga said everybody. I was screaming at the TV. I dare you to say me, nigga. I dare you. Has anyone ever listened to me do comedy? Have I not ever said anything about these things before? So now all of a sudden, this nigga expects me to step in front of the streets and talk over the work these people are doing as a celebrity? Ask me, do you want to see a celebrity right now? Do we give a fuck what Ja Rule thinks? Does it matter about celebrity? No. This is the streets talking for themselves. They don't need me right now. I kept my mouth shut.
Are you a fan of Dave Chappelle?
I love Dave Chappelle, and I know it's on there. I was actually going to probably pop it on when we got off here to check it out.
I watched it twice today. I actually, don't tell my boss, I watched it at work. It's only like 27 minutes long.
Okay.
It was released simultaneously on Netflix and on YouTube. It's called 8:46, which unfortunately is the time that cop's knee was on George Floyd's neck. And it's really just, like I said, it's only like 27 minutes long. And it's just a little, like, to call it stand-up would be weird. It's just him talking to a crowd in his hometown in Ohio. And it's like almost like a little, like, park pavilion that, has a little stage and he's up on that. And the audience is there kind of spread out and everybody's got their COVID masks on and shit like that. But he's really, like, giving a state of the world address. And it's, you know, I wouldn't call it a stand-up special, but it's not something, you know, it's not like an overbearing kind of speech. It's just him being real and talking about what's going on in the country and people's reactions. And, you know, he comments on how, you know, people say, oh, well, what does this celebrity think? And he's like, who gives a fuck about what celebrities think? You know, this is what's going on. It's more about what's going on in the streets. And it's very powerful. Very powerful. I mean, it's 27 minutes that flies by. But, you know, it's not it's not like half baked. It's not full of joke. It's just him talking real to the crowd, and it, very poignant, very powerful. That I think it's a message that everybody needs to hear and watch. But I don't want to give off the feeling that it's like preachy or anything like that. You know, you're not watching a sermon or a propaganda film. It's just a guy getting on stage and being real and talking about what's going on. But I think any fan of Dave Chappelle can still enjoy it. And even people who aren't fans of Dave Chappelle, but just can relate to the chaos that we're living in right now. I think it's very important. And I think it's something that is going to be looked down upon years from now as a really, like, important moment in his career and just in pop culture in general. I think it was a really brave thing to do and a really honest thing to do. So check that out. Either go, you know, if you don't have Netflix, everybody's got fucking YouTube. Dave Chappelle 846. That is my something new.
Yeah, I'm definitely going to check it out, man. Everything that he's done, I don't think there's a dud in his stand-up catalog. You know, the pre Chappelle Show stuff all the way through Chappelle Show, and then, you know, when he came back, great, great specials, man. I think he's just a comic genius, man. He's great.
Oh, I put him right up there with the greats. He's up there with Pryor and Carlin, you know, Lenny Bruce, you know. As far as, you know, those were all comedians who, aside from just being incredibly funny, were very socially relevant and talked about real shit, but made it, you know, they talk about some dark shit, but they'll make you laugh at the same time. And sometimes, you know, I think they make you see the hypocrisy in society and how everybody's a lot more alike than you are different, you know, and you can take shit that everybody can relate to, even if it's a serious topic, and make people laugh, but more importantly, make people think. You know, I think that's something that Pryor, Carlin, Lenny Bruce all did. You know, you'd laugh at shit, but you would think too. And yeah, it's just very powerful stuff, man. I highly recommend it. What's your something new?
You know, my something new is this week, friend of the show, friend of Talk To Me, Bees over from That's Not Metal. He has a new show on knotfest.com, the Slipknot YouTube channel, and the Slipknot website, knotfest.com, called Mosh Talks with Bees. And he's one of those dudes, man, that I've listened to for the, you know,
Bees last Nuts.
Yeah, well, you know, actually, I think it is one of his handles was Bees Nuts for a minute. But he's from the UK. He's got a great accent. Anybody, you know, that British Australian accent, I know they're different, but they're similar enough, man. If I could get an accent, I'm going to Australia. But if I could get a secondary accent, it would be like some sort of European accent. But awesome dude, you know, we've been in talks over the years, kind of keeping up with what each other's doing, and it's just really awesome to see that he went from the That's Not Metal podcast to what he's doing now. It's called Mosh Talks over on knotfest.com and the Knotfest YouTube channel. And man, he's doing some cool stuff, man. He just had Tommy Lee on, Johnny Christ from your favorite band, Avenged Sevenfold.
Wow.
Yeah, you know, it's big names. He's got it's each episode has five guests, a big headline guest like Tommy Lee, and then it goes down to like a newer band doing some cool stuff there. So so yeah, man, I'm really enjoying what he's doing. So check it out, Mosh Talks with Bees over.
When do we get on there? When's he gonna interview us?
Well, I think once we put out an album or something. So.
Oh, man, all these stipulations.
I'll
check it out. I love a British or, you know, Australian accent. Not so much on a guy, but on a chick. Oh, my God. Oh, right. My God. I am such a sucker. A chick with a British accent. Oh, my God. Because no matter what they say, they can say the dirtiest, meanest thing, but it just sounds like eloquent.
Right.
Like, I would just love a chick, you know, like, Say, governor, why don't you put on me willies and stick, you know, put on me knickers and stick your willy in me bum. You know, right. I'd be like, oh, too late. I already came. Sorry. You know, and, yeah. And I got a friend, and she's a tattoo artist of mine. She's giving me a tattoo, and she's a friend, so I can't look her at her in that way. I mean, she's a gorgeous, absolutely gorgeous woman, but just to hear her talk, I mean, I'm just like, oh. You know what I can't stand is a hillbilly accent on a girl. Oh my God, does that have a girl talk like that? I'm like, oh my, I'm done. I don't care what you look like in Daisy Dukes. You're doing nothing for me. But, oh, my God, put on a British accent. You know, I'd fuck Adele when she was fat, you know, if she talked to me, you know, in that British talk, you know. God damn it. But, I'll check out your buddy.
Yeah, check it out. It's good stuff, man. He's a very natural talker. And, yeah, man, I'm really proud of what he's doing over there.
Cranky.
And you know what else I'm proud of? Another 2-hour episode of Diablos in Podcastica.
I'm proud of it. I didn't want to mention it because, you know, we're getting longer and stronger here. And he's like, God, okay, not another long episode. I got to edit this motherfucker. And I do. I feel bad because, of course, in addition to this show, you know, you do have the Amazing Talk To Me show that, you know, you have to edit that and stuff. And then you edit this, so... I appreciate, I just want to say here on record so everybody hears, I appreciate because I am a do-nothing leech, and there's probably a guy in a hospital that will back that up tenfold. I do nothing except tell bad jokes. I am like the worst partner ever. You do all the hard shit, and I know the longer the episode, the more work for you, but I also know that the audience really enjoys when I go off track, which I do constantly, and you're very patient with me, and I thank you, and I appreciate all the hard work you do on the show. So
I appreciate it, man. Yeah, you know, it's funny is when I'm editing the episode, I'm not really listening to what we're talking about or listening to the episode. I'm just listening for major fuck ups or when you go take a piss break or, you know, just when I need to, you know, put in a sample of this or that. You know, I'm not really listening to the show. And the other day I had it on my phone and it came on and I just let it play. And I normally cannot stand to listen to myself on a podcast. And so, and I actually listened to the whole episode from us talking about Ride the Lightning. And I was like, hey, it's actually a pretty decent little podcast. I like it.
I like when you sent me the text, you're like, we should have called this the Dum Dum Boys show. I was like, oh fuck, what'd I do now?
Well, I was just looking at the album tracks of that Iggy Pop album that you put out.
Oh yeah. Oh, I go, oh well, that's the title of one of my favorite songs, but what did I do something bad? Because it's so funny. When I do these shows, and I'm really afraid that I'm going to get like Alzheimer's and shit, you know, because it happened to my grandmother. I forget shit. Like the minute it's done, people quote, you know, my shows all the time, you know, and stuff that I say. And a lot of times, oh, I said that? Oh, I don't know. What'd I do? Oh, that's funny. And I'm always excited when somebody quotes something and I find out that I said it. You know, I was like, oh, that's pretty funny.
It's kind of like when you kind of dismiss Judas Priest and you didn't even realize you did it, you know?
Oh, man.
Yeah, it's funny. A buddy of mine was talking that his dad had a bluegrass talk show in the 80s or something. But he had all this box of cassette tapes of the shows. And actually, when his dad passed away, he got the box, you know, the box of tapes. And so sometimes when he's missing his dad, he'll just play those old shows of his dad talking, and he said it's very soothing. So he sent out to me a long time ago. He's like, man, make sure you save all these. I'm like, that's kind of eerie, but yeah, man, it's a cool thing to have, you know, for everybody. Hours and hours of audio, if something were to happen.
Oh yeah, no, it's funny because I see people post on our podcast page. You know, they post episodes that I did years ago, and they're like, oh, remember this episode when Ian was funny? And I'm like, fuck you guys.
Back
fuck
in
you
the day.
Guys. Yeah. I'm funny now, you sons of bitches. I think. I don't know because I don't remember.
Most of the shit that comes out of my mouth, man, once it's out, I have no idea what you're talking about. And yeah, I'll have people text me or I'll text. I like to text Chris Aiken, like just the like what he says. And he'd be like, "What the fuck is that from?" I'm like, "Oh, you were talking about, you know, racism or something, like whatever they talk about over there." But yeah, it's just it is funny how much, you know, we've talked for 2 hours and I can't even remember what we talked about. So
yeah. Oh, I text Chris Aiken all the time. I was like, remember when you lost that $100 because you said Sammy was coming back? That was funny. That was cool. That was cool.
Awesome.
I love Chris. Cool, man. He's a stand-up dude.
Yeah, he's a great dude.
All right, well, another great one in the books, man. Yeah. I thoroughly enjoyed tonight's episode, and I hope you check out our picks of the week. And, I want to give a shout-out before we get off. I think it was, and this is how bad I am with my memory, I think it was Jason Lee. I could be wrong, but somebody checked out my pick of the week the other week when I picked Geezer. And I apologize if I got wrong who checked it out. But they ended up loving them and buying like two or three of their albums. And that's the best. I love when people actually listen to what we suggest and check stuff out, because that's why we do it. Because we're trying to help you, motherfucker. You know? And it's nice to know that people do check out, you know, that we're not just doing that, you know, and you're like, oh, yeah, I already tuned out. I already heard the 4 minutes where they talked about the album.
And I heard a band today that I think that you might like. And it was a band called Lucifer with the female vocalist. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. No, I'm a fan of theirs. I dig them.
I heard this song today, I was like, this is Ian Wadley all day long.
Yeah, this is me. And actually, they're not my favorite chick singer band right now. I dig Lucifer. I ain't saying nothing bad about him. I dig him. But Ruby the Hatchet. I was so happy today. I saw somebody posted it in another group, and I know it's somebody that I had turned on to Ruby the Hatchet. One of the worst names. I mean, that shit makes Diabolos and Podcastica sound like a good fucking name.
Ruby the Hatchet Wound.
Yeah, no, horrible name, but a great band. And you and me both talked about how, you know, we're pretty iffy on chick singers for metal. You know, like, you know, but what a great band. But, you know, that's another band I talked about that somebody checked out. And, man, I love turning people on to fucking new music. So I'm glad. I believe it was Jason who dug that. But, man, you know, that you checked out Geezer and you heard what I heard. You know, like, hey, this is something cool and neat, you know, and I hope somebody checks out that Coheed and Cabrera album you picked, and somebody checks out the podcast, you know. Hey, you know, somebody's gonna be like, oh, Bee's Nuts, I don't listen to you guys anymore because I'm so hooked on Bee's Nuts, you know. But yeah, you know,
there's time for everybody.
But no, it's awesome that you know people actually listen to what we're talking about and value our opinion to a certain extent, to check out what we recommend, because we really are trying to help spread the word of other, you know, because there's more than Kiss, motherfuckers. There's more than Kiss. Check out some other fucking bands like the Cramps and right. Coheed and Cabrera.
And the Ace Frehley solo albums.
Yeah, don't check that shit out. Stop it. Life is short. Life is short. That's why I'm listening to new shit, because I'm thinking like, I'm going to fucking die soon. You know, just too much shit's going on. If it ain't the COVID, it's a goddamn murder hornets. I ain't going to be around forever. You know? Goddamn, how many times do I need to hear fucking, you know, Rock Soldiers? I would check out some new shit. That famous last words. The way this year is going, I'll probably be dead next week, kids. So eat this episode up.
All right, well, that will do it for another episode of Diablos in Podcastica. Make sure you're heading over to the Facebook page, sharing from the Facebook page, become a henchman, do our dirty work, and let everyone know about Diablos in Podcastica. So, for Diablos in Podcastica, I've been Joshua Toomey.
I am Wadzilla.
And we will talk to you soon.
Yeah, and if the economy picks back up, we're going to make some shirts and sell them to you, because we got to start getting paid for this shit.
I'm out.
Diablos in Podcastica with Toomey and Wadzilla.